internet, which I'm now doing even more obnoxiously after hearing Joe make fun of me for it a couple times. And welcome to Rabbit Stew. It's comic book day.
It's comic book day. Got it excited. It's comic book day.
Dude, I have a fever and chills. Like, I'm like barely holding myself up here. I'm going to be using my arm to keep myself doing one of these numbers. And I'm on a lot of Dayquil.
Dayquil.
Yeah. I downed a bunch of Dayquil right before this. I've only got to make it an hour. I can do this.
Got this. Hey, speaking of which, in an hour, your BattleTech Q&A is today at 2.
Yep. I got 1 hour. Let's do this.
Let's do this.
Let's talk about some comic books.
Welcome to Hyper RPG. This is Rabbit Stew. Hyper RPG is an interactive, hyperactive, premium quality Twitch channel powered by you, the viewers. This is Rabbit Stew, where on Wednesdays we talk about comic books and comic book related news.
Indeed.
To the left of me is Zach, your overlord. I'm Scott.
On my right.
And I'm on the right.
That's right. He is on my right.
Yes.
So. Let's get into it.
Let's get into
it. Should we start right off with the Vanquished recap?
I think we should.
All right, you got this.
Okay. So, Valiant Vanquished was on Monday night, so let's talk about what happened. Basically, it was the it was like an infiltration mission the whole time. The team, the four of us that were sent out to save Rhea Eves, went and infiltrated a PRS facility with the help of Galushi on comms.
Yes, Galushi.
Yes, our favorite old Scotsman.
With his scotch and bagpipes.
Yeah, yeah. All of his patriotism.
All of his stereotypes.
It's pretty great. So the team goes in, flying in a helicopter. They break the helicopter a little bit on the way down because I guess we just couldn't help ourselves.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Of course.
Yeah. The poor pilot had to walk home because Galushi's a dick.
Yes. Poor Mandy.
And we get some instructions from Galushi that makes it pretty clear that he thinks we're all a lot better than we are.
Well, he's under the assumption that you've, on your own, escaped PRS for this long, which you have.
Yeah, we have. We have. But it's like, I don't know if any of y'all out there watch Red versus Blue, but there's a twist at season like 11 or 12 where after all the things they've been through, somebody comes to them and is like, "You're the greatest soldiers of the galaxy. Look at all these things you've done." And they look at each other and they're like, "Wait, us?
Yeah.
We suck. We're four episodes in. We're already that team." because of all our hijinks. So, with Livia in charge, because it is clear to Galushi that she is the most capable member.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is weird, because by just calling her the most capable, she became the most capable.
Yeah. Livia was awesome on Monday night. Proper fight. I'm maybe pronouncing that right. You're totally right. Livia was MVP. Although, Rhea Eves had some badass moments.
That she did.
So, basically, yeah. the team of four, all we really did was just fight our way through the facility to Eves. We were supposed to sneak our way through the facility, and the first fence we found...
Did anyone really think that was going to happen?
Not even a little bit.
So I planned out an option for sneaking. I had like worked really hard on coming up with like a really like fun option for sneaking and doing this as a silent mission through the whole thing. And of course, like right off the bat, you guys were like, nah, fuck that.
We immediately sound the alarm.
Fuck that. Let's just see that electric fence there. Just probably hooked up to a bunch of wires and everything. Let's just blast through it.
Yeah, not after I tried to turn it off, overestimating the power of my arm, and just blew myself away the hell back. I took some pretty good hits
of damage.
We
give so many awesome fan art moments. If you really think about it, there's so many awesome fan art moments in that episode.
Yeah, there were a lot in that episode, especially.
Sprofite says Eves rescued herself, which is kind of true.
So the team blundered its way through the halls while Eves met her captor, who we learned is Mr. Silk, who that was exciting for me.
Yeah, because you're
like,
a Valiant fan.
Oh, man, Mr. Silk is here. Oh, we are way in over
and
our heads.
Like, yeah, right.
Like,
you're the only one at the table who knows. Well, I'm sure AJ
knows,
too.
Too.
Yeah, Holy Zero X, thank you for that follow. That's... You know who Mr. Silk is. AJ knew. I don't know if the rest of the people in the group have got to any books with Mr. Silk in him yet. Dude, there's very little information on Dr. Silk and WebNet.
There's really very little. You've got to find him.
That's Dr. Silk. Yeah, we should show them.
Yeah, I was thinking this is a good picture. If you guys are wondering what this Dr. Silk fellow looks like.
Oh,
damn it.
Oh, wrong button.
Okay, put you over there. Do that, that's, and...
That'll work. That'll
there
work.
We go. So that is your Dr. Seal. So that is the face of the man that that Eves had to deal with.
Yeah, he's totally normal.
Totally normal.
Totally normal, dude. Totally normal guy. He, you know what's crazy? He shows up in 4001 AD, too.
Yeah, yeah. He's a big
part
of Rai.
Which is unfortunate because there is hyper RPGs now. Man, I wish those test alerts weren't so, like, hopeful.
Yeah, they're so exciting. Oh,
you're like, oh, hosting is for 1,800 viewers. Oh, it's a test.
It's testing, okay.
God damn you, Twitch alerts.
Genova Plus, yeah, I kind of am purposely blowing through plot points on goofy stuff. Part of it is that we only have an hour today because we have the Battletech QA.
Oh, no. In Vanquished.
Oh, I'm blowing through them on Goose. I thought you mean I'm skipping them in
Okay, so basically a plot point isn't just for badass action moments. It allows them to be the GM for a moment.
Yeah, and you know, they say there are two sides of the spectrum for an RPG gamer for this, right? There's ones that are like gamers and they're trying to, you know, really they're really focused on the objective. Mm-hmm. And they're the ones that are really the role players and just focused on the character. What would the character do in this scenario?
I like character.
And I'm like this thing we're sitting here, we're both thinking like writers the whole time. I'm thinking character the whole time. Most gamers of course exist on the spectrum there. And part of it is that since it's a performance, the whole time I'm thinking what makes a good show. You know, mm-hmm. but I'm limiting myself, of course, to the genuine motivations of Alara, so that they're all there. But there are times that I'm like, this, you know, this would just be a great beat. This would be funny. And also, I think it's funny a little bit when Alara stumbles, but he needs to stumble because he is the dumbest one. He is really overwhelmed in this world.
So basically, when he's using that plot point, what he's doing is allowing what he wants to succeed.
Yeah.
Without me making him roll an intellect for it, basically. He's gotten around the roll for intellect.
Yeah, that's I figured it out.
He by using that plot point, which makes for a more fun show and a more exciting moment. You don't just have to use them to do really, really badass stuff. They could technically use those plot points for rerolls. They could use them to buff a roll. Mm-hmm. It doesn't just have to be for super, super badass awesome stuff.
And I have used them, definitely, because I'm like, all right, I really need this attack to work.
Yeah.
So I'm using this plot point for that. But you know, it's that I really get behind the idea of this is a plot point. I if I'm gonna spend a plot point, I want it to be a moment. I don't necessarily want it to be a gimme, right? I don't want to be like, all right, this one will just, you know, we'll do this for that.
So I want to know if there's anyone out there in the audience who has started reading Valiant Comics after watching this show and trying to catch up on some of the things we're talking about, because that's what's exciting to me. I'm now going back and rereading Archer and Armstrong because I've finished everything. I've finished every single thing they've published since 2012, but now I'm going back and rereading Archer and Armstrong because I'm like, shit, I think there's some things I forgot. My brain's starting to get all jumbled with all the information. But as far as Dr. Silk goes, what's crazy is we are in this universe. What's exciting about bringing in these big players is that we get to explore how their impact will affect a team like you guys, and if you're even like a blip on their radar right now. And the other aspect though is I can't have you killing Dr. Silk,
right? Yeah, we can't be having
he shows up in 4001 AD, so
yeah, he can't die, but we have thus we get his bodyguard character,
right. But that being said, they might be able to kill one of the clones of Dr. Silk.
Yeah,
because he's the kind of guy who's probably got a clone anywhere. And
he's got a clone army. There's stands to reason that he would have some clone backups too.
Right.
He's that kind of guy. He's plugged into the internet. It's possible he's gonna be one of those cyborg Superman characters, you know, that just like is a consciousness that travels through computers. That's not Dr. Silk, but he could be. He could be in like two books. You could make that his thing. You wouldn't need to do a lot of character changes.
Well, in this instance, I don't know if we made it totally clear, but when she tried reaching into his mind, he had uploaded his memories.
Yeah, he said his memories were elsewhere.
He put his memories, I don't know if I fully went into it, but the idea is that he put his memories in the cloud because he had researched how Eve's powers work, but they were unaware of where those powers came from. So he put her in a Psyot dampening room, and now he knows, as a person who's experimenting on her, that she's not a Psyot.
No, she's not a Psyot.
So, because it is in the Valiant universe, it is a little difficult to pinpoint where people's powers come from. It's not like a mutant gene.
Yeah,
or this
almost
or that.
Almost all of it is Psyotic. Most of the people with powers in the Valiant universe are Psyots, but there are a lot of other things. There's enhancements. There's tech-based things. There's some magic in there, and then there's some otherworldly things that could be providing powers. So
we did learn today that, or on Monday, that Erida continues wanting to do really amazing thing with her powers, but she hasn't quite got the experience to do so yet. She really wants to make that ice cloud or like ice sheets and all that stuff. And Galushi thinks she's got it within her. But we do have to stick to some aspects of the RPG and wait for her to level up, per se. It's cool that she's like coming up with these ideas in her head of what she wants to do.
And thinking about the way the power works, right? Well, okay, if I can turn water to steam, that means I'm changing the temperature of it. I'm affecting the thermal energy of water. So that could stands to reason the next step direction. Is to go the opposite direction.
Right. But we started on her power set of being able to turn it into steam. So we have to wait for her to level up to be able to flip it the other direction.
We also got a little tease for the powers because of what Galushi said to do. He was like, all right, Livy, you teleport the whole team inside, and Erida's going to make ice licks, and
you're going to interface.
Alara's going to hack a computer and know what the word computer means in the first place.
Meant to be a tease of like Galushi can see that these are what these characters should be able to do, but you guys know you're not there yet. So that's kind of a tease for the audience that months down the line, we could have a team on our hands that can teleport into a location, have you interfacing with a machine, and Alara creating like an ice wall and stuff, or Erida creating an ice wall and all that kind of stuff. Like, we could get there one day.
Yeah.
But we are in the beginning parts of this team's journey, which is exciting for me. I'm excited to see where this show is a year from now.
Yeah, and I
think it's going to be a totally different show.
It's going to be
so different.
You guys
are probably going to be in outer space fighting with Exo Manowar.
Probably, yeah. I was thinking,
nuts.
Like, we got to, like, you know, we'll probably have to deal with the Vine at some point. I want to see some armor. They're like, oh, the armors are so cool.
Get the armorines. We'll throw you guys in a bunch of armorine suits.
Yeah. So there's
so many different ways you can go.
And that's part of why it's cool in the Valiant universe, because I think that the storytelling style that we're doing fits with Valiant in that sort of slow burn, where in mainstream comics, and we'll talk about this today when we end up talking about New Superman, your first issue has to be, like, ready to go. And, like, when you read Harbinger, the first issue of Bloodshot, you totally understand what that book's about. Yep. It is about violence and awesomeness and this guy's tortured history. And Harbinger, you kind of have to read the first full trade, I think, to understand this story. And through the end, I think that my favorite ongoing series has been Harbinger, because it's the one that really, it has a slow burn. It really builds these characters up in a way that you
Harbinger Omegas and everything, you're just like,
oh, yeah, so brutal.
Massive. It builds to this massive thing.
So I think that's great that we have the room to really do this.
It's exciting.
Alara in armor. I don't even know if that would work. I don't know.
We'll have it built to where your arm is still outside.
Right. There's
it.
Just like this armor set that just has this got, arm
and it's
out
got like right. It's got like a protein backup source. It's like pumping proteins into the arm.
It's not like a backpack with just like some meat in there. Yeah. Go to a butcher shop and load it up.
So let's get back to the recap. We have so much more to explore with all this.
Oh yeah, there's lots of room.
So we did, as far as what we learned this episode, we kind of learned how Eve's powers work a little bit more because they've been researching her. I threw a lot of stuff out there that wasn't privy to our players, but was privy to our audience. Once again, the Black Block came up twice.
Yes.
In the show, unbeknownst to you guys as players.
Yeah, we have not. The only time we've heard or seen the name Black Block is on that one USB, and I think only Cross saw that name.
Right. And Eves did hear it in passing through Dr. Silk talking about the bad information that was collected and all this stuff. And we had hinted towards the Black Block in the episode before. Obviously, I know where everything is leading towards. You guys don't in the audience. I've seen some interesting fan theories already popping up in the chat room, which I love seeing.
That's awesome.
I love seeing stuff, and I'm like, nope, but close. I'm a big fan of that stuff, like watching all the fan theories start to pop out.
See, that's part of what I love about comics in general. It's like, oh, I got a figure out what's coming out next week, and
once,
know, it's all about...
Yeah, we did learn that Eve's being separated from Petunia. We also learned that Petunia was... guys, even though... as a storyteller, I'm not really big on exposition. It annoys me. I like rewarding people who pay attention. So you'll notice that when we do a lot of this stuff, a lot of things will be brought up in passing through conversation of players and not directly saying, this is this and this is this. Because that, to me, isn't as rewarding. So if you're paying attention, you'll know that there was a lot of stuff revealed about Petunia through passing conversation, through Petunia's importance, all that stuff. And I did start seeing people making assumptions in the chat. I've seen one person in the last 3 weeks that have guessed what Petunia is.
Really?
One person.
I don't even know what Petunia
is. And that same person has changed their opinion three times. But at one point, they got it right. And I've seen it in the chat room
pretty good.
And I was like, ooh, they got it, but no one else has. So that's exciting stuff to like throw that stuff out there, build towards it, throw all these mysteries out there. And I'm excited to keep that story going.
Yeah, it's awesome. So basically that was it. We went in, we saved Reeves, who sort of got herself out. So we basically just went in and maimed. I legitimately tried not to kill some people. I legitimately tried. It may not seem like I tried not to kill anybody, but I legitimately tried a tiny bit.
Hey, Fred got out alive.
Fred and Bob got out alive.
Fred and Bob made it out alive.
Them. At the end, we do reunite with Rhea Eves, but she made a deal with Mr. Silk that would get her to Petunia. So at the end of the episode, she left us again because Petunia was too important, but not before taking the body cam that Galushi had given.
And it's not Livy. So much that Petunia's too important, it's that Petunia's absence is giving her withdrawals like a drug.
She cannot be without
the
dog.
It's like a drug, and she's actually having withdrawal symptoms with the dog gone, and she can feel his presence lingering, and she's going through the shakes and everything else. So it's an actual like bad situation that she's in. She can't survive. And I don't know if that was made, I don't think that was made evidently clear to you guys as a group, but made evidently clear to the people watching.
I think the audience got that, because I got that, you know, we were watching her solo scenes, of course. But like, yeah, as far as I'm playing it now, Nebraska is gonna be pissed that she left us again. You know, because he has no reason to understand that. You know, I just keep eating cats. I don't know that kind of bond.
Yeah.
So that's where we ended with the team sent on basically another rescue mission. But this time, Eves knows what's up.
Right. Eves knows what's up. She's the inside person. It'll be interesting to see how far that camera makes it. You know, this is Dr. Silk we're talking about. He's not dumb. He is not.
Man,
dumb.
It's a good thing she's the one with the camera. Because if it was Livy or me or really anybody but Erida, but probably Cross 2 because of Geist, that camera wouldn't have made it 5 minutes into another episode.
That's very true.
But she'll be able to hold on to it, okay.
She'll be able to hold on to it. So that was basically the episode. If you guys haven't checked it out yet, you definitely should. And we're still not telling you a lot. There were a lot of crazy moments, a lot of really funny moments. I thought it was the funniest episode yet.
Yeah.
There was a lot of combat. Every episode's been pretty funny. It depends on what you find funny. This was more combat funny. Yeah, the last one was more situational funny.
There was a certain amount of genital mutilation.
There was definitely genital mutilation.
We got the name hashtag Team Dick Punch. So I guess we got that going on now.
Yeah, hashtag Team Dick Punch.
Yeah, that's right. I ate the alive guy's leg and the other guy died right next to me.
It's weird, though, because I feel like if this was a comic book in the Valiant universe, it's becoming the, like, Deadpool team comic book.
A little bit, yeah. It's a little Quantum and Woody-esque.
Yeah.
Where we're like, we're doing all these really, we're kind of like Mr. Magooing our way through all these really difficult scenarios and just stumbling our way to success somehow.
Yeah.
Plot points help.
Yeah, plot points help. It is there. Yeah, I think Quantum and Woody is a good representation. I'm amazed you didn't eat the severed penis. That's the next step.
That was the one thing that finally managed to gross Nebraska out. Was when I saw half of somebody's penis portaled somewhere else and heard the sound of it fall out on the ground. I was like, this is
too much.
This is where he breaks.
No matter how hungry you are. Cats, that's fine.
Cats are fine.
Eating cats and leaving their fur and skin behind is totally fine. But
that's totally okay. Making a wood chipper out of my arm and spraying all my companions with blood and whatever else is coming out of the back of it, that's fine. But
someone did say earlier that they really like the show because the five characters are so different that it feels like a bunch of different comic books together as one. And that actually is a really great compliment, and it makes me proud of the team we put together for this, and that they all have very distinguished different characters with different ideals and different goals and power sets and all that good stuff, because we worked really hard on that, and I'm excited to see where this goes.
Yeah, me too.
We're really proud of the show.
We are really proud of it. The characters are all cut from whole cloth, I think. They're all real, fully developed characters, and at the time, like, I know, I think especially Nebraska, so it right now seems like an archetype.
Yeah.
And that's intentional. In that, like, these characters all have also a lot of room to grow.
Mm-hmm.
And
if you've seen, we've given each character room to grow per episode, and I'm sure he'll have his day soon. Whereas we had an Erida episode 2 weeks ago, this was very much Livia's chance to grow.
The Hijinks episode was a little bit my episode, in that it was just like a Three Stooges episode with everybody beating up on Alara, but that was fun.
That was fun.
And we, of course, have to always give honorable mention to Joe, who's always on point with the sounds. Sound effects are fantastic.
It's So we're really proud of this show. If you guys are fans of it, make sure to tell all your friends who like watching other role-playing game shows on Twitch. It's really hard to get RPG shows that are unknown, that are not D&D seen by people because they don't know to search for it. But what I do know works on Twitch is collaborative storytelling. And we just definitely need people to know about it. So help us get the word out. Tell your local comic book shops, your friends, posting your favorite clips or GIFs online. Those things go a really long way to help make our shows successful. And the more people that watch them, the more cool things we're able to do with the show. That's the really big thing, is if you guys are fans of the show, the more people that come in to be fans as well allows us to then do even cooler shit with the show. Mm-hmm. Because it gets Valiant more excited about it. It gets other, you know, PR companies more excited about it. And then we get to be like, you know what? Why don't we try this thing?
Yeah. The more you guys support us, the more you guys watch the show, the more weight we have to go to Valiant to be like, we want to try this cool thing, and have them be like, yeah, this is worth us.
I mean, they want to support
the storyline.
They honestly are like dying to support the show. We just got to get our numbers up a little bit. Mm-hmm. So working on it. Okay, I'm like getting really dizzy. Let's get to the news.
All right, let's look at this. This is pretty cool. This is kind of news. But you guys familiar with the band Churches with a V instead of a U? I'm not really, but I know of them because I listened to music from 20 years ago, and I'm lame and don't.
Yeah, I don't know shit about this band, but when I heard that.
Jamie McKelvey, the artist of Sex Criminals and Wicked. No, that's Chip Zdarsky. Yeah. Of Wicked and Divine.
Wicked and Divine.
It apparently helped produce this music video with Churches.
He directed it.
That was it.
Yeah.
Cool.
Directed the video. Yeah. So we're going to watch this video and watch this sweet animation. If you're a fan of Wicked and Divine, that's what it's all about.
Yeah.
Kind of. Definitely looks like Wicked and Divine. I really like the animation. The music is way too happy for someone like me. It's too positive.
There it is. I was thinking it didn't sound like Hayley Williams. Now it does.
So if you guys like this animation style, you should definitely... Oh, that's a little Shiba. That's a little kaiju, guys.
Look at that.
If you like this animation style, you definitely should check out Wicked and Divine. I can tell you Wicked and Divine is not this positive, though.
No.
Holy shit. It is not this happy. I mean, it's pop. It's pop music. Wicked and Divine definitely represents pop in the pop music world. But it's an interestingly kind of dark premise. Shielded with pop.
It's a very Kieran Gillen book.
Yeah. Dude, Fanagram, like... anytime I'm, like, getting... If I'm missing music, rather than listen to music, I'll read Fanagram. Or yep. Phonogram. Yeah. It makes me, like, remember why I love music.
It's awesome.
Cool.
That was cute.
Yeah, cute I think is the right word. I love the animation. Music's way too happy for a fucking old geezer like myself.
I like music with instruments. But other than that, it was pretty fun.
I'm just cranky. I know why other people would like it. I get it.
Definitely. I mean, it's what's popular today is that, like, really upbeat, like, you're having fun music. It's the music that tells you you're having fun.
I mean, that's kind of what we try to do right on now. Our channel, too.
Yeah.
You know, like, I understand that my place in the world is to be this cranky old man that you guys all watch try really hard to be like, you guys are having so much fun.
That's why he needs me next to him to, like, love Superman and stuff.
Yeah, right. I mean, it's one of those things that, like, it's a weird balance because I really do want everything we do. And I want people to be happy. Okay, here's the difference. I'm always trying to figure it out. So, like, I am, yes, a cranky person. And an old geezer and all that kind of stuff. But I'm not a hateful person. And there's a big difference. I can be cranky and expect more out of myself and expect better from the world around me and not be hateful. I may seem cynical. I'm just not overly, like, happy positive, which is fine. What bothers the fuck out of me is when I get on the internet and I see people just like, this sucks. Fuck that. Okay, like the comments on that music video I was reading this morning.
Oh, YouTube and comments? What were you even doing, man?
Well, I know, but it's just one of those things where I'm just like, look, I don't necessarily... The music's too happy for me. It's not my type of thing. But I'm not a hateful person that's just going to be like, you know what? I'm going to tell this band that I don't like it.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to go on their comments and be like, this song sucks shit. You know, it's like, I don't like it, but I understand why other people do. And what I don't understand is that we live in this world where, like, there's just hateful people.
Yeah.
I don't like... hateful people.
Yeah, people just hateful people can suck a dick. And like, screw that. I'll at the very least figure out like what you don't like before you just right. decide not to like shit.
Right. It's one thing to not like something. It's another to respect the fact that other people do like something. People can like whatever the fuck they want. Hateful people could suck it. There's too many of you out there in the world right now.
Yeah. If people like something and you're not part of it, just be like, hey, people are stoked about a thing. That's cool.
Yeah.
You know, that's how we as geeks feel. A lot of people don't understand comic books, but we all know that it's just awesome. And so if somebody else feels that way about something, be like, hey, that's like me in comics. That's cool
right,
to have that
right,
thing.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. It's cool that other people get that thing. Monty Blanc says, I like trains.
Trains are cool.
Yep. And Trinity said, suck a dick in a not good way. Touche, sir.
As opposed
Touché.
To suck a dick in a good way.
Touche. All right, so we got this Batman Beyond intro HD video to check out, right?
Why is this? This was just, I thought it was just on loop.
Oh, that was just on loop. I thought yeah. you prepped this. And I was
no,
like,
I
wait,
just,
why are we watching this?
It was just on loop in the studio.
That's
like,
just Joe.
It reminded me of a minute of my childhood over and over and over.
I was
going to
say, like, what?
Oh,
okay. I was like, what's going on here? Oh.
We're just watching Batman.
I guess Joe's keeping that from the screen going dark
yeah,
this morning.
That's exactly what it is.
All right, so what else we got in the news?
So let's see what else we got
going on. I've had too much cough syrup.
Yeah. Let's talk about some of the big news, which is Marvel Now 2.0 lineup leaked.
Yeah, it did.
And, you know, of course. Emerald City, or San Diego Comic-Con is coming up, so there's a lot of news leaking from all of the companies.
Oh, yeah.
And so the big one here, though, is Marvel Now 2.0, which is just the next, you know, big initiative, the next big wave of comics from Marvel. We've seen some of this cover art here, but the big thing that they leaked was one page that had a list of about 50 different titles that seem to be coming out, and that's going to be the last image on the bottom here. Some of these covers are, you know, intentionally provocative. Like, we got the Spider-Man kiss with Miles and Spider-Gwen. We'll see what that's all about.
Yeah, probably means nothing.
Yeah, that's going to be, you know, this weekend. Covers that have nothing to do with the books inside of them.
You know, maybe he gets a little bit of crush, but he's interested in Ms. Marvel, and things get weird, and it's blah, 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 blah.
Yeah. So as we know it right now, which this is a leak and we know nothing, we think things, that's all. We don't know anything yet.
Yeah, so you know what? Let's go ahead and be one of those news sources that tells you, here's the facts that we know nothing about.
Yes, this is a rumor, so we're going to act like it's all now. We're not going to be those guys.
Okay, so all those things that you're seeing go out today that say this is this and this is that. For all the people that think because of this list that you're now watching stuff that says X-Men's canceled.
X-Men's
these
not
are not
canceled.
Facts. These are... Yeah. I'm actually gonna message Dan Casey and Kyle later today and be like, yo guys, I'm gonna put money down against you Nerdist, and I'm gonna be correct. Dan, I'm coming after you, Mr. Casey Osteoporosis. I'm coming after you, buddy. I think you're jumping to conclusions here way out of proportion. Because the storyline that I see being pitched in here with the death of X has to do with Cyclops, not the death of mutants in the Marvel Universe.
Yes.
Because Cyclops, as we know, the old Cyclops before Secret Wars, was a big player in the Marvel Universe, and there's been hints since we came back from Civil Wars that he did a thing.
And granted, it was...
And he's gone.
Before Civil Wars... before Secret Wars happened, the Terrigen Mist wasn't negatively affecting mutants. Mm-hmm. It wasn't killing them and sterilizing them. Now it is. And so I think we're just going to learn that Scott Summers is to blame for that.
Yes.
Basically. What we do know about Death of X is that it will explain that missing 8 months. It'll be co-written by Jeff Lemire and Charles Soule, who are the main writers on X-Men and Inhumans, respectively, and the Inhumans will be involved, which means I'm going to have to read all of it. But something like this happened once, about 20 years ago, maybe a little less. It was early 90s or middle 90s. And they canceled every X-Men book. And they had no internet. Everyone freaked out. There was no like, oh, hey, don't worry about it. X-Men's going to be around. You're going to be fine. They canceled X-Men. And what actually happened was they were going to do a whole bunch of new books in the Age of Apocalypse.
Yeah.
But they didn't want to give away the whole Legion going back in time and killing Xavier and starting the Age of Apocalypse, or killing Magneto or whichever one he kills. Didn't want to give away what started the Age of Apocalypse. So they... just canceled everything, and it was this big deal, and then boom, this giant event came out. I'm almost certain that's what's happening now. They're ending all of the books because a giant X-Men book is coming out, and they don't want to have to deal with it crossing over into all the books.
Mm-hmm.
When Death of X is over, there'll be a bunch of new number ones with X-Men in it.
Because number ones sell better, as we know from all the fucking number ones that are on this list.
Rules the rules.
I'm getting tired of number ones right now, if you want me to be totally honest.
And I agree. Like, I mean, we just did Rebirth, and I was like, I feel like we just did this. We just did it with the DC YOU, we just did it with the New Phase 2, so Marvel Now, we did it with
The first Marvel Now that happened a couple years ago, I thought was really great. It came at a time when there hadn't been many number one
those
reboots.
Those things need to happen maybe every 5 to 10 years. Yeah.
And they had so many good creators on those books. Now, they've done it 3 more times since then. Give me a fucking break, man. We get it. I read your books. Now, you're bringing in new people. I understand. But a lot of those creators that made the first edition of Marvel Now so amazing have all left.
Yeah.
They've all gone on to do indie comics.
Because they keep having to restart stuff. They want to do an ongoing series.
They did
series.
Amazing books that I think Marvel was at its peak 2 years ago. Marvel was kicking serious ass with the creators. There's some good books on the stands right now, some amazing books on the stands. But as a whole, it's becoming really convoluted again, which is what happened to me after like Civil War back in 2007.
Right.
Things got really convoluted for a couple years, and then that original Marvel Now reboot I thought was fucking smart. Some people hated it. I really liked it. But now we're like in this really weird, super convoluted stage again, mm-hmm. and I'm just getting fucking... burnt.
Yeah, I see that they see how many people read a number one. They see the numbers that the number ones bring them, and so they're trying to do that. And what they're doing is they're getting a bunch of new readers, but they're not establishing a bunch of long term readers. And that's really like when you read a comic book and you just have to keep reading the next one, then you start being curious about other books in that universe. Start reading those. That's how you get caught.
Here's a really good point from Baronator. They might as well cancel X-Men. They won't give it really good stuff unless Fox starts playing ball with Disney, Marvel in a big way. Somehow, well, guess what? They are. And that's why I think this is all bullshit rumors. Marvel's set to co-produce an X-Men-based series on Fox.
But even then...
on TV.
Until
they're
now...
they're not gonna fucking just
at
disappear.
At no point has Marvel bailed. We've been seeing this every few years since this whole... since Disney bought Marvel and there's been now Disney-Fox crap to deal with. Every few years we've seen Marvel is shitting all over the X-Men. And that's not true. They for like the last 4 years, gave their biggest writer, Brian Michael Bendis, the X-Men to run, right? Marvel wasn't doing anything. Brian Michael Bendis just, decided to have Beast fuck a bunch of shit up. And that's just storytelling. And the same thing is going on now. Like, Marvel doesn't care about Disney and Fox. Marvel comics don't care about Disney and Fox.
Why would they?
And they and Disney and Fox don't give a flying fuck about the comics.
Because it makes no money to them.
Yeah.
Look at Disney as a company.
Yeah.
Do the people that try to say that these comic books are marketing for the movies, okay, well... or is it the movies are marketing for the comics? Let's really think about which industry here actually needs more help selling stuff.
Yeah, and it's...
movies are fine.
Really, it's a little bit neither. Nobody, like the movies, they make people interested in comics, but they know not to model
the
movies.
That's why, exactly, that's why the movies don't follow the comics. The comics follow the movies. A movie comes out that makes a shit ton of money, all of a sudden you'll see the next run of comics, be like, whoa, shit, we need to change that. We need to pick up those
Deadpool
movie
books.
Fans. Exactly. Now there's 14 Deadpool books. Okay, yeah, that's a good fucking example. Who owns Deadpool? Fox owns Deadpool. For all these people, like, they're canceling X-Men because of Fox, blah, blah, blah. There are more goddamn Deadpool books on the stands now than there's ever been.
Yeah.
What? Why aren't they canceling Deadpool? Come on, guys. It's because Deadpool's selling well right now, and X-Men isn't. X-Men isn't. If the X-Men movies brought more hype to the comics, you'd see a bunch
actually,
of new X-Men
they
comic
are selling pretty
out.
Well. The X-Men books are, with as far as the Marvel lineup goes, they're doing. They're among the top. They're doing better
well,
than
back
Squirrel
in the day.
Girl
well,
Ms.
back
Marvel
right. But back
now.
In the day, X-Men.
Yeah.
For a while,
which
X-Men
is why
was
they
the
brought
top.
It. Yeah, it was at the top, and it had like 9 books, and they had to bring it back down to 2 because they had to do that. Then it got popular again, and now they're going up to like 5 or 6, and they're doing a big event because of the Secret Wars thing. You know, Scott Summers is gone, Xavier's gone, Jean Grey is gone. I guarantee you, Death of X is going to bring at least one of them back.
Yeah. Well. Yeah.
Because they can't help themselves.
We got the young ones.
We're
going to put the young ones as bigger
we
players.
We just got a movie worth where it's all about Scott and Jean, you know? And we still, and Xavier's still Xavier. So I think that's going to happen. But you can take solace in that we are 98% certain that X-Men will not be canceled.
And we're not saying the facts here. We're
list.
Saying we're using common sense as comic book readers who have been reading this shit for our whole lives. We're not going to clickbait article you. We're not going to be like, you know what? We need more people to watch this. So we're going to say X-Men's getting canceled.
Here's the real secret.
I'm writing Dan a message. Because I think it's bullshit. I think just like people have been asking me like, hey, aren't you excited Dan slots off Spider-Man? Okay, look, if that was true, yes. Stay to Silver Surfer. I want my Spider-Man back. I want Mark Waid to write Spider-Man. That's what I want. But because Gary Conway, is it Conway?
Yeah. So
he's going to be writing Renew Your
Amazing
Vows.
Amazing Spider-Man Renew Your Vows will be Gary Conway, who, by the way, is the guy that killed Gwen Stacy.
So he's going to be writing Renew Your Vows. So Amazing Spider-Man Renew Your Vows, what does that mean to me? When people are like, oh, look, Dan Slott's not writing it, and it's going to be part of this new Marvel Now lineup. It means to me this is an offshoot. It's not part of the timeline that's currently created because it was part of the Secret Wars. And it was kind of a thing in the Secret Wars that sold okay. They'll probably do another 4 or 5 issue run based off of where they left off in Secret Wars because that was its own contained story. And then we'll go right back into whatever Spider-Man currently is right now. They're not just going to reboot Spider-Man where he has a daughter and he's back with Mary Jane.
There's no way.
No matter how much I want him to, they're not going to do it. It's just another chance for it's going to be a limited run book, most likely, and then they'll go back. They're just taking a break from the other one. Like, they do that all the time. This happens all the time. And just because this was leaked doesn't mean all the other things are canceled and this shit is now out.
It's awesome about this. The new Marvel Now will be happening right after Civil War 2 ends. There will be things, this happens every time there's an event, there will be things that they cannot advertise yet because they don't want to ruin Civil War 2. We will be learning about new books. This is exactly what happened with Secret Wars. They're like, this book isn't going to happen, this book isn't going to happen, and then started filling it out. However, we did end up, we still don't have Fantastic Four. So everybody who said Fantastic Four is going to be gone, they were right. But that was just Jonathan Hickman's fault.
Well, yeah, he kind of set them up. Yeah. To not be a book anymore.
Yeah, he was like, oh, this is the perfect ending to the Fantastic Four. And also, if you put anybody on that book, after Hickman's run, after Secret Wars, you put any writer short of, I don't know, Joe Quesada himself, or Grant Morrison, or somehow you get Alan Moore to do it, you put any other writer on Fantastic Four after Hickman, and nobody buys it because nobody cares. Right?
Yeah, he kind of told, like a 3 to 4 year storyline.
You can't follow that.
Secret Wars, like, kind of wrapped it all up. Like, honestly, Secret Wars wasn't...
Thank you for that follow.
Secret Wars wasn't wrapping up the Avengers stuff as much as it was wrapping up what Hickman had done on Fantastic Four.
It was
Four.
The conclusion of Hickman's work on Fantastic Four.
The
and
relationship
we just learned
of
that his Avengers run and stuff tied into the Fantastic Four stuff, not the other way around.
But somebody asked how many books does Valiant currently have going. I think Valiant always only has 8 books coming out in a year.
I think that's about right.
Yeah it's like 8
it's
at
like
a time.
Somewhere to 8 or 10 or so.
Yeah. It's really easy to follow, basically. It's usually, it's 2 comic releases a week with a total of 8 per month.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. So easy to follow if you want to jump on board. I mean, there's things on this list that excite me, such as Nova number 1.
Yeah.
Because I'm a Richard Rider motherfucker.
Might get Richard Rider back.
I don't mind Sam. I've liked some of Sam Alexander's adventure. I liked his journey to find his father, finding out that it's not what he thinks it is, and all this other stuff that's going on in his world. I like that he's become a player on the Avengers, and we have a very young Avengers group right now. But I miss me some Richard Rider. And a lot of people, because they don't read the comics, are saying Marvel's now hinting at the return of fucking Richard Rider. I'm like, they've been hinting at it for 2 years, damn it.
What we do know is there will be a new Nova book.
Right. That's we know there will be a new Nova book.
That's all.
They've also been hinting at this for a very long time. They even did an insight kind of into what happened in the Cancerverse whenever there was one Brian Michael Bendis issue of Guardians of the Galaxy where they kind of reflected back on what might have happened with Star-Lord in the Cancerverse and Thanos, because Thanos is out, Star-Lord is out. We ended, like, when Guardians of the Galaxy kicked off, the last we had seen of Star-Lord, he was trapped in the Cancerverse with Thanos and Richard Rider. They told that story. And they've been hinting at his return for a while now. So if Thanos can get out and Star-Lord can get out, you better damn right Richard Rider is going to get out. You got the fucking Nova Force coursing through him, and he was left in there with the fucking Cosmic Cube.
Oh,
he sacrificed himself to keep...
Which, the Cosmic Cubes are what it's all about these days,
yeah,
too. So yeah, that'll probably be a thing. I'm excited about Genndy Tartakovsky, the creator of Samurai Jack and Dexter's Lab. And Hotel Transylvania he wanted to do a Luke Cage book that would be set in the 70s, you know, like kind of an anti-blaxploitation Cage book. And that was a long time ago. He pitched it and it was going to come out, and now it's finally coming out. Some fans of Luke Cage have been waiting for this book for a long time. I recently learned about this, so I can't be one of those, oh, this is finally happening for me, but I'm excited that this is happening because I didn't know it was going to happen, and I would have been excited if I did.
That's pretty sweet. How do you do it without making a blaxploitation?
That's what I'm kind of excited to see.
Yeah, because I mean, he's a great creator, and I don't doubt. I mean, if you think about Samurai Jack, it's almost like Asian exploitation in some ways. But he found a really unique way to tell a story that makes it not about being like exploitive. It's just like pretty good. Crowbar Samurai. Welcome. Hello.
What are you doing? Thank you for following. All right, we only have a couple. We have like 20 minutes left for the Q&A. Should we just get to the comics?
I don't know. What's this Marvel Ultimate Alliance epic supercut trailer? Like, what's that all about?
What? Is this just a trailer for both Marvel Ultimate Alliance games?
I don't know what this... Why is Spider-Man in that shot? Okay, so now I'm curious. Let's see what this is all about. Somebody, one of our mods, put this into the news document.
Okay, let's check it out, because, sure, we like trailers.
Why not?
Spider-Man's there, we'll watch
it. I see Spider-Man all of a sudden running behind Hawkeye, so curiosity peaked.
Everything that has a beginning has an end.
You were made to be ruled. In the end, you will always kneel.
We will tear them apart.
Destroy everything.
If they made like a new Ultimate Alliance video game.
Using shots for movies.
Loki, this is madness.
I was a king, the rightful king of Asgard.
You can't kill an entire race.
Do you really think fate turned us into gods so we could refuse these gifts?
You are all that stands in his way.
You can't handle this alone. That's why I'm bringing in Smell.
Who's the furball?
Superhero landing!
Hey, everyone.
Hi.
The world is literally at stake. I need your help.
I still believe in heroes.
Can you estimate how many he has?
An army.
He means to lead them against your people. They will win him the Earth.
I like this.
This is interesting. Some really bad shots, but
some of them mixing look quite great, but
I'm not gonna let that happen.
Our war will rage. Your cities will not be safe. You will not be safe.
We have to act now, and not one of us can do it without the others.
And we stand together.
As a team.
Captain?
Suit up.
Bunch of jackasses standing in a circle.
Language!
This makes me remember how much I want a new Marvel Ultimate Alliance game, though.
Yeah.
Did you play that shit back in the day? Like X-Men Legends and Ultimate Alliance?
I didn't play it back in the day, but I played it recently.
Dude, I would play the fuck out of that game. I still do. I still boot up X-Men Legends on my ROM on my computer
once in a while. My girlfriend and I are in the middle of an Ultimate Alliance playthrough right now, together.
Part of a plan. What percentage?
Nerd.
I don't know.
12%.
That's love right there.
12%?
Wow.
What the shit?
Cue the music.
Yeah, I fucking love the first Ultimate Alliance. Ultimate Alliance 2 is just okay, but Ultimate Alliance 1, like, this game is fucking rad. One of the coolest things I got to do when I was a Geek and Sundry was direct Felicia Day and Ryan playing Ultimate Alliance. My suggestion was, oh, you guys play Ultimate Alliance for Co-Optitude. And then we got to have Deathlock play with us.
Nice.
That was actually pretty cool. That was a cool day. Sometimes there were cool days over there. And I was just like, oh, cool, I'm playing Ultimate Alliance with Deathlock. This is rad.
I recently learned about X-Men Legends being the predecessor to Alliance. I'm like, gotta fucking play that then.
Yeah, I still play Marvel Heroes too. I haven't booted up Marvel Heroes in a while, guys. I just haven't had time, but I fucking love Marvel Heroes. Love that game. It's a good time waster for me whenever I'm like at an airport or something. Who just started playing Marvel Heroes? Who said that on our account? Why aren't we playing together, yo? Joe! God damn it, Joe! Dude, I've got like 20 characters in that game, and I'm friends with the devs. Let's play that shit.
So yeah, that would be really cool if that were a thing. I like how they used the only shot ever of Wolverine's mask in any movie.
Yeah, right?
I sounded like, hey, that's the only time we've ever seen that.
Okay, so that was actually pretty...
That was pretty cool.
It was cool. It makes me just get really hyped for wanting more, like...
Yeah, I'm gonna go home and play some Ultimate Alliance tonight.
Yeah, man.
That'd be good.
So that was one aspect. So we're just going to talk about a couple comic books. While we've got like 13 minutes left, man, I got to stop talking. You talk.
All right, let's talk. Let's first we gotta mention that we get our comics and our comic show is brought to you,
is
of course.
Really, really, really hot in here.
It is very warm in here. Yes.
I'm gonna open this door. I'm sweating my balls off.
We get our comics from Alter Ego Collectibles here in Redmond at the Crossroads. They have this cool website where they show you what is going to be released today, ordered by how many people are subscribing to it. So you can see here the sort of window into who is reading what in Redmond, Washington. And as always, number one is Deadpool. This is Deadpool number 15. Actually, usually it's Star Wars. There's no Star Wars this week, so it's Deadpool. This is the Civil War 2 tie-in. The Mercs for Money hate Deadpool and want out. Wait, isn't there a new Mercs for Money series launching? How is that going to work? So this is going to be Deadpool versus Deadpool, it sounds like. So, okay. I'd imagine there's going to be some meta jokes about series ending and relaunching.
Of course.
Which they could probably use
this
some of their medicine.
This week, huh? This all is right. An interesting week.
Civil War 2 number 3. That's the big one we got to talk about.
All right. So, spoilers. You guys don't care. Tell me about, because
so,
I haven't read it.
I'm going to explain Civil War 2 because he's not read it.
I haven't read it.
There
but
will
it's
be
okay.
Spoilers. Like, we always talk about Civil War 2. This is the book we talk about with spoilers. Basically, this whole issue was framed in a trial. Sort of through flashback. Daredevil was the main lawyer. He was talking to Carol first, and then he ends up talking to Clint Barton Hawkeye, because we then flash back to right after the last issue, where basically everybody has shown up to confront Bruce Banner. We thought it was just Carol. It's the Inhumans, it's the Ultimates, the Avengers, Tony's there, everybody's there.
Which makes no sense to
me. Yeah, not at all the right play.
In the last Hulk issue that I read... They make it very clear that they're aware that Banner isn't Hulk right now.
So they go to him.
Known fact.
And they don't talk about it. It's still, they have seen the future, though. And
in that future,
and it is
they
explained,
can see that it's not Bruce.
I guess so. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if they look a little different. At the very least, we're supposed to say for granted. They know it's Banner. And it's, you know, all goes into this conversation about should we trust Ulysses and how much. And anyway, they start... Tony's like shows up and is like, we all gotta be calm because we know about the Hulk and all that. And Banner makes it clear that he has been testing himself. He's been testing dead gamma radiation on himself or something. There's some science stuff that, of course, is meant to be vague so that it works for the Hulk. And Tony makes it clear that that's bad. He is not super down with whatever Bruce is doing. So it's just some escalation. They go outside and they talk, and Bruce Banner is beginning to get a little bit angry. And as he's beginning to get a little angry,
hey, Evil Door, thank you for that follow.
Evil Door, thank you for following. Bruce Banner is beginning to get angry, and then boom, out of nowhere, a purple arrow comes and hits Bruce Banner from behind and kills him, right through the chest. So the Hulk dies. Now we flash back to the trial scene. I mentioned this is around a trial, and it is, of course, the trial of Clint Barton for having potentially killed Bruce Banner. And what he says is that Banner told him. He said, Banner told me to kill him if he ever seems like he's hulking out again. And I thought he was going to hulk out because I saw a green flash in his eyes. If you go back to the art, and we actually see a flashback again, we see the face twice in the book, his eyes are not colored green. And this is a big enough book, I assume the colorist would know better. His eyes were not colored green.
Well, here's the other thing, too. If he had any Hulk in him, the arrow through the chest wouldn't have killed him.
It wouldn't have killed him. It would have turned him into
the Hulk.
Which
sounds like a stupid thing to even set up to say, oh, Barton was told to shoot him if he was the Hulk. And it's like, dude, fucking Banner knows that that's not going to work.
If you are the
Banner
Hulk, then you
know
that there's
a special kind of arrow.
Oh, he did. He did. That is part of it. It was a special Banner arrow.
Okay.
So it does have dead gamma. So there's that, but it's still, he wasn't the Hulk in the first place. And we should have had that conversation. So Banner's just dead, which at this point, we've got She-Hulk almost dead, Rhodey's dead, Banner's dead. I'm wondering if there's enough deaths that this might all be undone. This might be one of those events that just gets undone at the end, because there's going to be a point at which like we've gone too far, and comics got to be comics still. But at the end, Tony is doing his research. He's back in his lab.
Oh my God, what if they do a really stupid thing that by the end of this, at the very end, this was all a vision of what would happen by Ulysses if they go a certain route before,
that the whole thing is just a vision.
That they're all going to come out of it at the very end and be like, if we continue down this route, this is what happens.
You know, I think that would be hilarious. Like, I would laugh. I would not buy another Marvel book for a long time, but I would laugh every time I did. That's how it would go down. I'd be like, that was hilarious.
Well done.
Fuck you. Yeah, exactly. So let's probably not going to do that, but we'll see how it goes. At the end, Tony's computer, Friday, which, you know, the floating head of a woman that talks to him because Tony has to be talked to with soothing woman voices by soothing woman faces that look like Mary Jane Watson. Friday says to him, we've finished analyzing his powers and we know how they work. And he's looking at the screen. We don't see the screen. He's like, I'm looking at the future. And then that's where it ends with the cliffhanger. So in Civil War II, number four, we're going to learn about how Ulysses' powers work, which definitely means it's not going to be how we think they work. Because it's not just going to be he sees the future, and that's it.
No, it won't be. Can't be. So the book I want to talk about today is Wrath of the Eternal Warrior number 9 by Raul Allen with the art and Robert Venditti with the writer. Any week that this book comes out, we're not going to have it in there, sadly.
Oh, no.
Because they don't care.
Because everybody's taking it.
Any week that this book comes out, it's going to be my number one pick as long as this book's on the stands. Because this book is owning my fucking life right now. I got AJ to start reading it, and he got flipped out over it.
Oh, yeah.
It is some of the
AJ's
best.
AJ's losing his mind about Wrath. He thinks it's so
great.
It's crazy.
Some of the best sequential storytelling I've ever seen in a comic. It is just so good. The color, the panels, the repeated panels to show the significance of time and how like things have worked over time. It's blowing my mind. It's so good. We now know who the dying one inside the labyrinth is. He's this creature or person who, like Gilad, is eternal.
Another eternal.
But different. He inhabits a body, gets old, dies, comes back, reborn, with the knowledge that he gained
so
in his last life.
It's an eternal consciousness.
It's an eternal consciousness, but not an eternal body. And he's experimenting on Gilad to try to unlock how his eternal body works because he wants that.
Oh.
He wants that power. He's tired of having to go. He's only in his prime for very short periods throughout his eternity.
Of course, especially.
Whereas Gilad is always in his prime.
Yeah, he's
the always
fist
in
the
steel.
Prime.
So they're trying to replicate it, and it's fucking so good. There's things that happen in the first couple books of Wrath where you're like, I don't really see how this plays in. Okay, so he's fighting his way through hell and everything else. Now he's back. And you start realizing how important this family that lives in the afterlife is to this story. And that there's a deeper story being told here about his relationship to his families that have died over the centuries. And
Venditti's good at the long game.
Oh, man. It is so good.
Yeah, I got to...
I'm loving it.
So this is your pull of the week?
This is my pull of the fucking year right
now. There we
go. This book is owning me. I get excited to get those emails because I get the press copies, and like when I see that, when I see the email from Valiant that says Wrath of the, I'm like, ooh, and I open it and stop what I'm doing and read it right there. I also read the new Bloodshot Reborn. It's pretty good. It's interesting. Lemire's doing a good job in the book. I liked the first two trades really, really well. I'm still unsure of where they're taking this right now, but
The Bloodshot problem. Every ongoing just kind of like ends up petering out.
Yeah. Well, it's a hard. It's he's like Wolverine to me.
Yeah, exactly. Like Wolverine. There's only so many solo characters where you're like, we gotta throw him with a team before we run out of interesting stories.
Exactly. Exactly. He's a little too based on just like man with memories torn apart. Wrath is proving to be a really interesting story because you have a character who's immortal, and there's a lot you can do with an immortal character, and a lot that you can do with like. And now that they've introduced this thing that like he's not just immortal. He's not just a guy who's always been on Earth. He dies.
Yeah.
He does die, and it's the Earth itself that chooses to need him and to make him reborn, to make him a protector of the Geomancers if the Earth needs him.
Yeah.
So it's like you see this. He
Such
has
an
this,
awesome character.
He has this family life that goes on in the afterlife. He gets to only be with his family and the loves that he and his children and the people that he's loved over his eternity when he's in death. And he has to choose to listen to the Earth and go back and to be a warrior for the planet. It's so good.
Yeah, it's great. My pull of the week this week is also by Robert Venditti.
Really?
He is writing Hal Jordan and the Green Lantern Corps.
Well, there we go.
Which is probably going to be pretty far down there because nobody appreciates Hal Jordan enough. And actually,
or Venditti.
Venditti's Green Lantern has gotten mixed reviews because it's really hard to follow Geoff Johns. I have enjoyed it, and I have enjoyed it more and more and more as it goes on because, like I said, he is very good at the long game, and things pay off very well in his run. So the Hal Jordan, the Green Lantern Corps Rebirth issue came out this week. So did the Nightwing Rebirth. I know that because me, you're all disappointed that I'm not going to be able to talk about how much I love Dick, but there's some great Dick on the shelves this week. Narrowly beaten out by my love of Hal Jordan, who is the greatest Green Lantern of all time. This got me really excited about
Dude,
what
there's
Venditti's
a new Birthright this week, too. Man, I got so many books I got to read
so
this
books.
Week.
So yeah, Hal Jordan's back, basically. It's the continuation of the Green Lanterns were gone. He's got this giant thing, and he crafts a new ring in this issue, and he's like, I gotta be the Green Lantern again, I gotta be Hal Jordan again, and I gotta bring my core back, which is not gonna be easy because Sinestro, who's old and withered, is now basically the Guardians. He is the dominating peacekeeping force in the universe, the Sinestro Corps. So a war is coming, and it's gonna be probably not what we expect because Hal and Sinestro are not gonna go to war again. They're gonna talk and they're gonna throw us for a loop. So Venditti's crushing it, basically. That's, you heard it here.
You heard it here.
Robert Venditti's books are good, and you should read them.
All right, guys. So that's pretty much all the time that we have for today because we're about to switch it over to BattleTech. And just so you know, in the future, we will be making this a slightly different show in the coming weeks and making it more focused directly on just comic books, not Rabbit Stew and comic books, but just a comic book show that is its own thing. And we will work on rebranding that soon and also moving the BattleTech stuff to possibly an earlier time or different day of the week so we don't interrupt our comic book talks.
Yeah.
And thank you guys so much for tuning in and all that good stuff. We are going to go to a quick break and come right back with the BattleTech team giving an update on the Kickstarter and everything they're working on. So, thanks, guys. Great.